knows exactly what's going on in the heart of men and women. He knows what's going on in my heart and in your heart. The things that motivate us, the things that, yeah, we worship, the things that we look towards and admire and worship. God's judgment is based on truth. He knows the depth of our heart and the way that we think. And he hears the things that we say when nobody else is around, perhaps listening. He knows what's going on in our heart, and God's judgment is based on truth, knowing exactly what we are like. You remember some of the teaching of Jesus. I just wonder, Jason can confirm this, you know, he's done all the high-tech Bible stuff and Bible college stuff, but I wonder if Paul was proofreading Luke's gospel at some stage. You think he might have been? He was obviously a friend of Paul, but perhaps it's the same author at the background, the Holy Spirit, that is saying the same things. But Luke was reminding us of something that Jesus said about judgment in Luke chapter 6, verse 37. He says, "Do not judge, and you will not be judged. Do not condemn, and you will be condemned, and you will not be condemned. Forgive, and you will be forgiven." That's the teaching of the Lord Jesus. Yes, there are sinful things going on in the world around us and in people that we meet, but ultimately they've got to stand before the judgment throne of God and hear God's wrath upon the things that they've done and the way that they've walked. It's not for us to bring condemnation or judgment upon it. And Jesus went on to give this parable in Luke chapter 6, in verse 41. "Why do you look at the speck of sawdust in your brother's eye and pay no attention to the plank in your own eye? How can you say to your brother, 'Brother, let me take the speck out of your eye,' when you yourself fail to see the plank in your own eye? You hypocrite, first take the plank out of your eye, and then you will see clearly to remove the speck from your brother's eye." You know, I was taught that Jesus was using a little bit of comedy there, and I suppose it is fairly amusing that you can have a speck of sawdust in your eye, and you know what that's like, and someone comes along with a great plank of wood out of their eye trying to remove that. So it's quite an amusing picture, but at the same time, it's a very serious picture, because as Jesus tells these wonderful stories, he knows what the heart of men is like. He knows the way that we think and the way that we are. And he knows how easy it is for us to fall into that trap, even though we've got our own wrong, to point out the problems that other people have and think somehow we can administer that. This problem of finding fault with other people, this problem of criticism and always identifying the error in others. It's like a disease that can take us over. You know, Christian people, we can get into the habit of thinking, "I can see what's wrong with that person, and I can see what's wrong with that person." Remember when I point the finger at Jason, I have several fingers pointing back at me. So Jesus knows the heart, even though it's quite an amusing picture of this speck of dust and this plank of wood. He knows how easy it is for us to be self-righteous and judgmental and forget that each one of us needs that grace of God and that forgiveness of God. So there's a lesson there about judging others. Also in our passage, there's a lesson about the need for true repentance. It says, God's kindness is intended to lead you to repentance. Notice it's God's kindness there. God's kindness intended to lead you to repentance. You know, you could easily say, "Repent or I'll thank you." It doesn't sound very kind, does it? But it's God's kindness. He's saying, look, turn around. Don't go in that direction. Because he loves us and cares for us, he calls us to repent. We need to understand what that word repentance means. It means turning around, going the other way, choosing a different set of rules and motivation for our life, rather than being self-centered and doing those other things and, that we've already read about in the last chapter. What repentance is, it's turning around. And it's vital that we truly repent in the way described in our passage here. I need to confess to you this morning that about a couple of years ago, I had another woman enter our life. And her name's Carol. We might explain sometimes why she's called Carol. She helps out with some of the marital tasks that Linda used to perform, actually. And she sits under the dashboard of my car. She was talking to me as we came along this morning, saying things like, at the third exit, turn right. Or turn immediately left. And on at least two occasions this morning, she said to me, make a U-turn if possible. She knows the way ahead. She knows some of the roadworks are going to be. She's very clever. And she knows how to guide me. I think, no, I'm going to go my way. In fact, we came a pretty way this morning, so we turned off the route for a little bit. But she patiently said, okay then, you go on that road, I'll still get you there. So that's Carol. But you see, sometimes we hear this voice that says, you're going the wrong way. Make a U-turn. Go in the opposite direction. Our Father God doesn't want us to go in the wrong direction. He wants us to follow his leading through to that eternal destiny that is ours. He doesn't want us to go off course and to wander off course. It's so easy to just slightly go off course and to wander off course here or there. And he says, make a U-turn. You're going in the wrong direction. Because going in the wrong direction in our life has got serious consequences for us. You know, we can go down different sinful routes that can destroy our health, can destroy our life, can destroy our peace. Not only going in the wrong direction can destroy all that for us, it can destroy it for our families as well. And because God is kind, he says, turn around. Don't go that way. Come back on course. And going in the wrong direction, you know, can even cause problems for our nation as well. A nation with people going in the wrong direction. And God, in his kindness, says, repent. Turn around. Remember King David, the sin that he fell into. You couldn't imagine it being any worse. Adultery and murder. In Psalm 51 we read, David crying out to God, create in me a pure heart, O God. Give me a new beginning, a fresh start. Cleanse me. Enable me to turn around and go in a new direction. It's surely unnecessary for me to bring a message like that, this, to the fellowship this morning. You know, we had a communication from the church that I used to lead in Milton Keynes a little while ago, and it really broke my heart to hear it. This guy who used to play the guitar in a band had a lovely wife and two children. He heard he'd gone off with another woman, and his wife was trying to pick up home pieces on her own and sell some of the stuff to make ends meet and bring up her children. I wonder when it was that he started to go off course. I wonder if he could just hear that kind voice of God saying, turn around, don't go in that direction anymore. Turn around now. Just a disaster for his wife and for his kids, and ultimately I'm sure it will be for him as well, when he comes to regret the path that he took. Sadly, in our churches in Britain today, it is necessary to bring that message. Don't go in these directions that lead you to a complete failure for your family, your home. Turn around, in God's kindness, he leads us to repent and turn around. We need to understand when we become a believer, there's a need for repentance and faith. We have faith in the work of the Lord Jesus on the cross. On the cross, he forgave our sins. Through his death, we can receive life. We have faith to say, I will trust in you for my future. I will trust in you to love me and care for me and direct me. But there's got to be a turning around as well. There's got to be a repentance. Repentance is not only a sorrow for sin, and there needs to be a deep sorrow for the sins that we've committed, that have moved us out from relationship with God, but there's got to be a choice to turn around, to truly repent, to choose to go in a new direction of following him. In verse 5, he writes, to those, because of your stubbornness and your unrepentant heart, you're storing up wrath against yourself for the day of God's wrath. That's the problem, isn't it? We can be stubborn. No, I've chosen to go that way myself. It's my decision. I call the shots in my life. I'll choose what to do, what to say, where to go, who to love, who to hate. And we can be stubbornly thinking, I must be right anyway. It's so easy to be stubborn and have an unrepentant heart, a heart that's not prepared to turn around and go in a new direction. And this is an example of the two different directions we could be going in. In verse 7, it says, to those who by persistence in